For one thing, we want to finish in time for David Nimmer to be able to return to his room before sundown, and we want Cary Sherman, who has flown in on the red eye from Seattle this morning, to be able, I think, to take another plane this evening. Am I correct about that? So we have miles to go before we sleep and promises to keep, which are two lines from the poem that I did not read this morning. Speaking of appropriation, our panelists, I'm delighted to introduce in the order in which they are seated and in which they will speak. Mark Hosler of Negativland, the Bay Area group that has managed to attract the attention of protectionist forces in the intellectual property field in the past. David Nimmer, adjunct at UCLA and of counsel to Arell and Manella, and of course, proprietor and custodian of and author of Nimmer on Copyright, now swollen by virtue of the increase in protection to 10 volumes and increasing month by month. And Cary Sherman, who is senior vice president and general counsel of the Recording Industry Association of America, and Rosemary Coombe, who is a Canada research chair from York University and author of numerous articles and books on culture and appropriation. I cannot think that it would be possible to present a better panel to discuss this subject, but I can think it would be possible to sit down and to let Mark Hosler take the podium, as he will do. We'll begin with a kind of bus and truck show from Mark, and then the format that we've settled on is this. After each presentation, we will take a kind of a small sampling of questions, but we have to limit those questions to about 5 minutes on each occasion, and we'll go Mark, and then David, and then Cary, and then Rosemary, and then with such time as remains, and with such enthusiasm, if any, as remains, we can come back and we can attend to more questions and more debate, and there will hopefully be time for the panelists to talk with each other and with you. So I give you Mark Hosler and Negativland.
Hi, thanks. This is going to be kind of a bit informal because I realized coming here I wasn't exactly sure who would be here and who I'd be addressing. But I think that hearing the stuff that's been brought up so far today and reading the papers, I read most of them all coming in on the plane, that what I want to talk about is really not so much legal stuff or academic stuff, but talk from the point of view of I'm part of a group who makes this stuff, creates this stuff, and what is that like? Why do we do it? And when I met Jamie, I don't know, in 96 or 97, I was very pleased to meet him because I'd been thinking that if Negativland was sort of like the Earth Firsters of intellectual property, that we needed to have a Sierra Club. And
I see myself as the Audubon Society.
Oh, you're the Audubon Society. Okay, but it was very interesting to me that he chose this analogy to the environmental movement, because that's something I remember thinking immediately. Is that's what you need. You need the Audubon Society, Sierra Club, Greenpeace, Earth Firsters, and some might think you need, what is it, the ELF and the ALF? They're on the real extreme. But anyway, I want to talk about creativity, and then I'm going to show a film, and I want to talk a bit about capitalism, too. I knew that would happen when I said that word. I'm 39 years old. I have been doing this since I was 16. I can't believe I'm still doing it. I can't believe that I'm being invited to speak in situations like this about the work I do. Because when Negativland started, we had no intention of breaking any laws. We had no intention of causing any kind of a hoo-ha with our work. We were trying to just do something that seemed interesting to us to do. And I love music. I love all kinds of music. When I want to be creative, what I'm interested in doing is making something that's not like anything I've ever heard. That to me, if I'm making something that sounds like something in my record collection, then to me, what's the point? I've never understood people who want to form a band that sounds like, you know, Black Sabbath meets Garth Brooks meets whatever their favorite combined together into music. I've never understood that way of thinking. So when my friends and I, and I also should mention Negativland is very much a kind of a collective of artists. I'm just one of five. But when we started making stuff, I was still in high school. We were fooling around in our bedrooms, making tape loops, tuning into the frequencies between shortwave radio stations, playing around in guitar, piano. We'd stick the microphone in the kitchen and record my mom baking the apple pie. I'd get the sound of my family dog barking. We mixed it all in. I remember that we were recording a track, the TV set, we were in the living room recording and the TV set was on. And we said, and it was on, I think the show was That Girl. And we just said, turn it up louder. We'll just get it mixed in with the track and maybe it'll be good. And we ended up with stuff, a lot of times grabbed totally at random from mass media. So this is in 79, 80. We liked the sound of doing this. I didn't know a lot about the history of audio collage at all. I became familiar with it many, many years later. We just liked how this sounded. It was fun to do. There was something that was exciting about taking things from the real world, ripping them out of their context, and throwing it into your own thing. So we kept making music doing this. And as we were creating, kept experimenting with sounds, grabbing things from here and there, we started thinking more and more about what we were taking and what it was saying. You know, what are the actual bits we're grabbing from a TV commercial, cutting it up, rearranging it, and adding it into me banging on a, you know, out-of-tune guitar with, you know, a drumstick or whatever I would be doing to make interesting sounds. So increasingly, I guess, our work started edging toward being, kind of having a little more sort of critical point of view, socio-political, critical content in the work. And we also increasingly became aware that this, we were doing something that other people didn't seem to want to do. It just kind of made people a little bit nervous. Now in the 80s, of course, there hadn't been any high-profile lawsuits about, or threats of lawsuits about sampling. Rap music was just starting to kind of burble up. And of course, it was the popularity of rap that brought the lawyers out at record labels sniffing for money. And so it wasn't until 1991 that we made a record that finally we basically stepped on the wrong toes. And that is this right here. Which, of course, we were sued for everything. And this of course is a Negativland single. It's called U2. This is a U2 spy plane on the cover. Kind of a reference to the fact that their name is stolen from something as well. And we certainly did this knowing we were doing something that was troublesome in some way. But if I have time, I'm going to play you a little video we made that's part of the track. But we're interested in making good work. And I guess one thing I want to talk about is that when new technologies arise, they offer new opportunities. And artists, are always going to be interested. A certain amount of them are going to want to just use the, I'm going to just carve something out of clay. I'm going to just paint with oil paints. But there's always going to be people who are interested in what's going on that's new with technology. And what can we do with it? How can we play with it? How can we use it in ways they never intended us to use? How can we plug? I always loved doing this when I was 16, taking effects boxes and plugging them into each other the wrong way and seeing what would happen. And sometimes, a lot of times nothing, but every so often something would happen that was totally incredible sounding, and you know, you'd work with that. So that same kind of impulse was going on for us in taking things out of the media and recontextualizing them. And funnily enough, for us, what felt really new and really different was using things that already existed, that belonged to other people, that had already been made. I mean, it's kind of an ironic thing, but it really did feel like that was interesting to do. And artists, not all of them, but some of them, you like to do things because you feel like you're sort of stepping into some place where no one else is going to go. That's exactly why it's interesting. That's exactly why this was so interesting for us to make this record. And the other thing is that I really think one of the reasons that our work did get so much attention is because I think we've done really good work. It's not just shit stirring. I mean, it's actually, you know, we worked on a record all about Pepsi advertising and advertising in general, and we're risking the wrath of being sued by PepsiCo. If we wanted to get sued by them over something, we probably could have jammed something out in about a month, but we spent 3 years making this record because we're trying to make a really, really strong work out of it and something that is complex, multi-layered, and critical, but in a way that isn't didactic. And collage is a really fun way to do that, because you're not actually saying anything. You're selecting things, and they're saying the things. And so the meaning is very much the final meaning of what you've created is really made in the mind of the listener, I think more so than when you're listening to the song lyrics and stuff. Since then, the kind of work that we've done that I felt transgressive to us has really become very much a part of the mainstream. It may be legally paid for, but if you look at just the aesthetic of collage, you can see it in advertising, it's in pop songs, it's in Puff Daddy, it's in, you know, it's absolutely everywhere. It's very much now just a part of mainstream aesthetic. And in a way, it makes sense to me. It's a very much kind of an end of the century kind of a thing, where you start recapitulating everything that ever came before you and all sort of put it into a new stew and see what comes out. And again, it's the technologies have made it incredibly easy to do. You know, an iMac just basically just, you open it up and it just begs for you to start stealing things and making fun things out of it. And that's all great. I mean, that's all really, really great stuff. We got involved in having to defend what we were doing when we were being sued, because we realized that, now this is back in 91, we realized, okay, personal computers are all over the place. There's starting to be more and more of those. Obviously, within 10 years, they're going to be absolutely everywhere. There's this thing called the internet. Obviously, that's going to become something major. Obviously, computers are going to get faster and faster. It's like I could just see what was going to happen over the next 10 years. It was obvious. And it was also obvious at that time there weren't people like in this room like we are now discussing these issues from the standpoint of creativity. It was all the stuff that Negativland was hearing was just from the interest of people who want to make a lot of money and who want to control everything. And we thought, someone has to say something different about that. So that's what we did. And we gathered together all the legal documents, the interviews, press releases, phone calls, faxes, and of course, this is all before the internet, so we actually had real physical letters, and we collected it. And we did this book, which we called Fair Use, The Story of the Letter U and the Numeral 2, which is not only tells the story of what happened, but it's an actual example. The form follows what it's about. I mean, it is made of stolen things or things we got without permission, you know, letters from U2's manager and Rolling Stone magazine and Island Records and credit reports, FBI, all kinds of stuff. So I've actually been told that this is even if you're not interested in this particular kind of law, this is an interesting document showing how the actual real life dirty crappy goings on behind closed doors of how cases are settled.
Mark, you might want to say something about the foreword too.
Oh, that's just more of a sense of humor, I guess. But we heard from Francis Gary Powers Jr., the son of the U2 air pilot, who is very interested in anything that has to do with his father. And so I was just so astounded to hear from him that I sort of tried to befriend him with kind of an ulterior motive, which was that I thought, if we can finish this book, it would be so cool to have him write the foreword to it. And really, it's just because he has the same name as his dad. But I thought it would really kind of, for anyone who knows that part of history, you know, it would kind of blow someone's mind to say, what? Francis Gary Powers Jr. wrote the foreword? So that's just a good example of how what we've been dealing with, what this book is about, is very serious stuff. But we have always had a sense of play involved in this and trying to have as much fun with it as we can. If you've ever been sued, you know, it's a nightmare. It's like having a living, dead zombie attached to your neck eating your flesh for 4 years. And this thing went on for that long. This thing dragged on for 4 years before we finally settled it. Yeah, okay. All right. So if you're interested in that, it's all in there. A filmmaker even made a documentary film called Sonic Outlaws. It's also about it. And also the film is made up of all kinds of appropriated footage. So let's see. What do I want to talk about here? To me, culture, by definition, is something that we share. And it just strikes me as just pure common sense that, I mean, it's kind of what Don in Negativland said this, when you copyright flowers, 1,000 do not bloom. That when you're creating, you respond to your environment. I live in this world. I'm on this planet as much as anybody else is, and I'm going to react to what's around me. And there's the, you know, there's the earth, there are trees, there's the sky, there's advertisements, there's billboards, there's U2's music, there's Britney Spears, there's all this stuff. It's out there. It's just all stuff. What's happening is that certain people want to say some of this stuff is off limits. And basically what they're kind of saying is that art is off limits. Art is something that you can't mess around with. Art is something that all you can do is consume. Or if we mass produce art, all you can do is consume it. I'm going to talk a little bit about that, because that leads into talking about capitalism. But what I want to do is just play you an example of what we create, because this will say to you, if you don't know our work, this will say a lot more than my words will say. We did an audio track that is part of the Fair Use book, and one of the tracks in there is called Gimme the Mermaid. And it utilized a section of the song from the Disney film, The Little Mermaid. How many of you have seen this movie? Good. Okay, you'll enjoy this. And I just want to tell you what's in here, because again, you know, people will say, you're just trying to justify, you know, thievery or something. Well, I'm going to show you something that I feel really basically stands as an original work. But however, it's made up of all kinds of stolen stuff. There's a loop in here taken from a Dean Martin song. There's a Disney thing in here prominently featured. There's bits from, what was the name of that TV show? Wise Guy sampled. And actually, another thing I should mention we do in our book, we've taken to doing now, is we actually list all of our sources. We do not get permission, but we credit everybody. So it... And the idea there is that we're just totally upfront. You know, this is what we're doing, and gee, if you want to sue us, you know. So everybody's in. We cited, since this book was about fair use, you know, it's called Fair Use, we thought this is the project where we can get Disney, Led Zeppelin, you know, who else is famous for? I'm forgetting that. The name of the yes, no, I'm forgetting. It's too long of a list. I can't find the name. Anyway, we figured if there's anywhere that was safe to do it, it would be here. Of course, we sampled from Two Live Crew in here too. And this track uses a recording we got a hold of. It's a phone call by a very angry music industry attorney who is threatening to sue someone over the telephone for copyright infringement. And it morphs into a kind of a cover of a punk rock song called Gimme, Gimme, Gimme. And we were also sued by our then record label. The record label were at the time, SST sued us, and that was one of their songs. And we just thought that was just appropriate. The lyrics were perfect, and in fact, it does count as being a cover version, actually. But what happened was we met a guy who was a big fan of our group. He worked on the Little Mermaid Saturday morning cartoon show for Walt Disney, and he wanted to work with us. And I was talking to him, and I said, Tim, we have this thing where we've created this audio track that actually uses stuff from The Little Mermaid. What would you think about, you know, reanimating? You know, what could you do? Anything? You have access. What could you do? And so, in the after hours, he just as you watch this, you can imagine this. This entire thing was created at Disney, and outputted on their computers between like 2 a.m. and 6 in the morning. And you know, and so there's all these laws that basically say what I'm about to show you cannot exist. This is wrong. But I love it. It's funny, it's great, and I'm pretty sure you'll really like it. It'll be a little distorted because the sound system here is not designed for music. So we tried to do the best we could.
We're just talking about whether it's convenient for you. I'm talking about over breath in this log.
Hello, Dead Dog Records.
Here comes the police. Listen to the car recording.
Car recording.
The one you're making as we speak.
Hold on a minute. I bet you guys are listening to everything.
The bugs are there for your protection.
I know.
You either have no ability to use this for any purpose whatsoever, either for free or for money. You want to test me in the court? If we did not buy ownership, we bought exclusivity. And if you want to try and check me out, and you go ahead and try and do something with it, and I'm going to sue your ass. You can never use it without our permission.
Maybe he's right.
So I sent you the check. I own it or I control it. You can never use it for anything without my permission. And if you want to challenge me, we'll go to court tomorrow and I'll prove you wrong. And you want to find out? Let's go.
Maybe he's wrong.
I'm telling you the facts of law and the facts of reality here. The reality is I gave you money, I own it or I control it. If you want to try and do something with it, I'm going to sue you. You never use it for any purpose again or I will sue you.
Maybe he's right.
I own the copyright.
Go get a lawyer right now. Let's have it out. I am not going to mess around with you about this. You can't use it without my permission. For anything, forever. Got it? Get a lawyer, because you're going to need one.
Maybe he's right. Maybe there is something the matter with me.
I'm going to sue your ass.
I just don't see how a world that makes such wonderful things could be bad.
You want to test me in the court?
Look at this stuff.
I own it.
Isn't it neat?
I control it.
Wouldn't you think my collection's complete?
You want to find out?
Wouldn't you think I'm the girl?
Let's go.
Girl who has everything.
You can never use it without our permission.
Look at this trove.
I own it.
Treasures untold.
I control it.
How many wonders can one cavern hold?
I'm telling you.
Looking around here, you think.
I own it.
Sure.
I control it.
She's got everything. I've got gadgets and gizmos aplenty.
You want to challenge me?
I've got who's its and what's its galore.
I'm gonna sue your ass.
You want thingamabobs?
I'm a fucking lawyer.
I got 20. But who cares? No big deal. I want more.
Need some more. Gimme, gimme, gimme. Don't ask what for.
Mess around with you about this.
Gimme, gimme, gimme. I need some more. Gimme, gimme, gimme. Don't ask what for. Gimme, gimme, gimme. I need some more. Gimme, gimme, gimme. Don't ask what for. Gimme, gimme, gimme. I need some more.
In the back of modernism and all this international law to make profit out of his own ungenerosity to humankind.
I'm glad you like that. That's great. Yeah, you can see how we were able to sort of, we put the Little Mermaid into a different context, and she becomes the voice of those forces that want to own and control absolutely everything. So, one of the things that I'm noticing in all the talk that's been going on and in the papers, whether people realize it or not or want to talk about it or not, is that there's sort of an implicit criticism here of capitalism, and that at some level the stuff we're struggling with here is, it's kind of like the end game of the logic of that the marketplace, you know, should dictate everything about our lives. That's all that matters. And it's hard for me, as I've worked with these issues over these years, it's hard for me not to see those kind of connections. I've gotten involved in learning about, you know, how does a corporation exist legally? Why does a corporation behave in this way that is completely unethical, immoral, unhuman, and just out to just exploit and rape the whole planet? Why? And there are reasons, and you probably a lot of you here know them. I mean, there's that decision in 1880. Someone here must know what the name of it is. In 1880 something, that where corporations were allowed to be legal persons, where a corporation legally has to just keep making money, or else its shareholders can sue them. So that it's like inherent in the structure of corporations that they're going to just keep doing everything they can to take over every speck of the world and try to figure out a way to commodify it and make money off of it. So I don't know, that's just kind of an observation, and it seems like the problem with that is that, especially now after 9/11, is that if you start talking about criticizing capitalism, capitalism equals democracy, apparently, and so if you're criticizing capitalism, you're basically un-American, or, you know, you're a terrorist. I mean, I've literally heard stuff come out of the mouths of some of our politicians since September 11th that literally have equated anti-globalization protests with terrorists, which is a terrifying and stupid thing for them to be saying. I think what's also interesting to me is that if you take the logic that we're seeing kind of at play here to its end point, in the end, I don't even know who's going to be left to afford to buy any of this stuff. Everything I've been watching over the last decade of where money's being pushed up, you know, who's getting all the money in the control and who's not, it seems like ultimately you're not even going to have anybody left in this country who can afford to buy your SUVs or your microwave ovens or your VCRs or your cell phones or whatever. So it seems like, in a way, that people who are struggling against globalization are really business's friend in a way that they fail to see. That you really can't just have this unlimited growth forever and ever and ever. And one thing that Don Joyce of Negativland has been on this faux list a bunch that he's been ranting about on there, he's quite a ranter, is that it would sure be nice if the internet, at least for a while longer, could just be kind of left alone and just let it be this, just see what happens with it, and instead of everyone jumping in and trying to figure out ways to kind of basically shove a round peg into a square hole. I mean, it doesn't, or is that a square peg into a round hole? It doesn't seem to work. Yeah.
Let me make this suggestion.
Yes.
How about segueing into about 5 minutes of deliberate interaction, sure, with people?
And sure.
And then we'll take a break, or not a break, but we'll move to
okay.
And then we'll come back and we'll do some more.
Okay. So basically, if there's a tension in copyright between protecting the creators and the public good, what's happened is that the creators now are all, at least the creators of mass-produced culture, are now all employees of these giant corporations. So what's really happening is you're seeing forces that want to protect the creators, but they're all driven by the people who are making millions and millions of dollars off of this stuff. So their interests are I don't think, are always exactly in the right place. And so we've obviously seen this incredibly ridiculous tilt to where it's completely away from the public good. And to the point where you see things like, to me, when I saw the RA lawsuit against Napster, at some level, I know there was a lot of reasons for doing it that made sense to the RAA and the music industry, but at some level, what it was like was, it was like a big fuck you to 25 million music fans who love music and are sharing music. And Napster really, what Napster should tell you is that people are craving a kind of a commons in a public domain to share ideas and share stuff, and they're going to do it. It doesn't matter what laws you make or what you say, they're going to do it. Except, of course, now we're going to try, they're going to try and legislate through hardware changes that just make it so you can't do it, which is also horrifying. So, anyway, yes, sir, questions. Yes.
Doug, did you choose the Little Mermaid with the ironic understanding that she'd already been stolen and privatized twice, first by Hans Peter Andersen and then Disney?
It was a nice little extra thing, but generally, I mean, we get inspired by the material we run into. We're not out looking for targets. You know, you run into this stuff and you get a good idea and you go with it. Which is also why Negativland now entirely runs our own record label, because no one would ever want to touch us with a 10-foot pole. We're a legal, potentially a legal nightmare. And we've also now been putting out, I actually brought some of this stuff. We've put out something called Plunderphonics, which is a brilliant work made by this guy in Canada, John Oswald, completely made out of cutting up other people's music. But incredible work, and really obviously not the original when you hear it, but really brilliant stuff. And we've been helping to get other work out that's like that. Because, so, you know, we're not really worried about, well, we don't have any assets, basically. If someone sues us, there's nothing they can get. So, yeah.
I was hoping, and maybe this question is a little premature, but you might be able to amplify on the issue of who the recording industry represents, say, as opposed to artists. Maybe they represent more of the industry itself, or do they actually have a real claim, in your opinion, to representing the works of artists and representing their ability to make some kind of money off them?
They do represent artists, but it's a worldview that, to me, just so, with such blinders on, that just fails to see that there's so many other ways to create, and that to me, if you're gonna make art and mass produce it and put it out in the world, then you just give up omnipotent godlike control of your work. You don't deserve it. It's not part of what making culture and art's all about. And I don't care if it's mass produced and it's a business, it's still art. And that's the thing that people will say, well, it's different because there's a business involved. And I say, no, you know, it's you can commodify it and still have these cultural concerns. What we need is an art court to be able to deter. We don't have that.
Let's take one more question.
I was actually curious when I read your paper about, I actually agree with you about the level to which you can modify art and use it and incorporate it into your own, but I was curious about what extent that's able to be done. I mean, can you do it to the extent where a person listening to it doesn't know that they're listening to a modified version? And are there problems that come out of that?
Well, yeah. Some people might say, well, your work kind of falls under this clear definition of criticism, satire, but what about, you know, Puff Daddy or something like that? And for us, we sort of don't see any difference. It's you know, okay, James Brown had this great idea to record music in this certain kind of way, and he made these records, and that's it, and he makes money off them, and great, good for James Brown. But should James Brown make money because someone then took a chunk of this thing and reused it in a different way? And our argument would say, no. I mean, there has to be an end. Because if James Brown should get paid for we sample him, should we then make sure James Brown tracks down all the session musicians he hired and we should pay them too? Or what if someone samples me sampling somebody else? Or so I think that the argument is largely sort of irrelevant, and that again it's I'd rather see a world where we err on the side of encouraging creativity, and occasionally maybe we do, you know, if something gets through the gate that's kind of a little bit like, that's really just not so cool. That's just kind of ripping them off. But I'd rather see that, a world like that, than what we have now, where I routinely hear from people sending emails to Negativland. I talk to people who are stopping what they're doing. I just wonder how much some people realize how much this impacts artists, visual artists, film artists, and audio artists. I hear from them all the time. They say, I wanted to do this, but I'm too scared to do it, or I stopped doing it, or I don't think I can distribute it, and it has had a terrible chilling effect. Yeah. Okay, thank you.
It's my job to play the heavy, and I am well cast. The thing is, we have four independent presentations. These are not inevitably interrelated. So we're going to move to David Nimmer and then to Cary Sherman and to Rosemary Coombe. And then we'll wrap up with the general discussion.
I'm most grateful to the organizers for inviting me here, although I'm not sure what grievous crime I committed against you to schedule me right after that very amusing video. All I'm relegated to are my devices at appropriating the works of others, which will not be nearly as amusing. But I will start by taking something out of David Lange's foundation paper. In short, appropriation flourishes. The copyright industries concede privately that it cannot be eliminated in individual cases unless a massive effort at brainwashing should persuade an entire generation of primary school children to accept the main tenets of copyright into their personal belief systems, and then to hold them there and act upon them, along with such other items of prescribed doctrine as flossing and transubstantiation. I was taken by the language mainly because of the recent copyright cases that I handled in the domains, respectively, of flossing and transubstantiation. Recently, I was before the Second Circuit Court of Appeals representing Colgate-Palmolive in a case brought by Crest in the following circumstances. Colgate entered the very lucrative Chinese market that had just been opened and dusted off something that you might remember from the 1950s if you were around then, namely an ad showing two eggs, one put in fluoride, the other not. After night, they're taken out. The egg with fluoride is tapped and it's solid. The egg without fluoride is tapped and the yolk's on you. As I say, that was dusted off and brought to China. Crest said, this infringes our Peruvian advertisement, and presented the two of them. Now, I looked at one. It didn't look much like the other. One guy's wearing a serape. The other guy's eating with chopsticks. You know, one's in Chinese, one's in Spanish. They're not all that similar, but it's true. Both do tell the story of putting an egg in fluoride and why that's good to prevent tooth decay and why you should go out and buy toothpaste immediately. That case illustrates something called the idea expression dichotomy in copyright law. Ultimately, the Second Circuit decided, no, it was independently created, but that's another matter. In any event, our client won, and it claimed that this is an appropriation of the idea, but not the expression. Okay, the other case I want to mention was recently in Oklahoma litigating something called the Urantia Book, a 2,000-page occult book put together whose devotees believe what it says, namely Revelation 1 was given by the archangels of Nebadon. Revelation 2 was given by the core of super universe functionaries, Revelation 3 by the thought adjuster, and on and on and on. It was registered as a composite work, a category of the Copyright Act that applies to something contributed by a great number of individuals, like an encyclopedia. Now, the parties that registered it, in fact, both parties, both my client and the opposing Urantians, both believed that it was a composite work. After all, it was written by the archangels of Nebadon and the core of super universe functionaries. I put it to the secular court that its job was not to investigate the truth behind the book, but rather to look at the circumstances of its composition, and lo and behold, it was all in the handwriting of one individual. Therefore, it was not a composite work. Therefore, it was not validly renewed. We actually prevailed on that, and that we will see what happens when we get to the 10th Circuit in Denver. In any event, those cases illustrate the two poles of copyright. The Colgate case, of course, is a case of transubstantiation. Namely, idea, expression, dichotomy, where do the boundaries lie? Substantial similarity, how substantial does it need to be infringing? Whereas the Urantia book, of course, is a case about flossing, namely, how do you take the language of the Copyright Act, composite work, and how do you apply it? Now, both problems are very big in the copyright realm. Jessica Littman told us this morning that if you want to do a service called, I don't know, let's say mymp3.com, and put up 10,000 songs, well, first you have 20,000 works, because there are 10,000 musical recordings, and 10,000 musical compositions, and 10,000 sound recordings. But of course, then there's a reproduction right, a public distribution right, and a public performance right. So you're up to 60,000 potential claimants. But who's to say that there's only one claimant for each right? When Billy Strayhorn just died, his estate was composed of five kids, a widow, and an executor. So there were seven people who claimed to own the copyright. So who knows? You might be 200,000 or 600,000 entities you need to go to. That's a very big problem of flossing. You need to get many dentists to get you through that, and in all likelihood, you won't find enough. But nonetheless, it is a mechanical problem. If you knew all the answers, you would be able to get to the end of it. Copyright law is built on much more tenuous foundations, namely the idea expression dichotomy, substantial similarity, and finally, fair use. What use is fair? Ah, that's a tough question. Well, I appropriated from Negativland something to put together the following chart, which was passed out to you. So if you got it in your materials, it's not on the binder, but it's a supplement. I decided to take the two categories that Mark and his colleagues presented, namely, if a work is productive, if it results in a new work of authorship, like the film that we just saw, okay, that should incline towards its being fair use. And if the work is not wholesale copying, if it doesn't take the whole matter that's copyrighted, that should incline towards its being fair use. And I decided in one day to chart all the cases decided since Campbell versus Acuff Rose in published decisions, and to see how they line up, to see if the Negativland prescription for what the law should be had any relationship to a description of what has happened over the last 7 years. Well, we begin with American Geophysical versus Texaco, and we see, okay, this is not a productive use, and it is wholesale appropriation, so Negativland would expect that's not going to be fair use, and indeed, that's the case for the first several. But let's move down to the bottom of the first page, three from the bottom, Billmore versus City Pages. In that particular instance, a policeman wrote a fable that was published in the Police Protective Newsletter. And the fable was about the good people and the bad people, and lo and behold, the bad people were all black people, and so it was an example of flagrant racism. The local newspaper republished in its entirety that fable, not to be a literary critic, but rather to expose what was going on. Okay, so here we have, once again, it should not be fair because it's not a productive use, not a new work of authorship. It is wholesale, so again, it should not be fair. And yet the court in that case decided, and I think it was right, well, you know what, that goal of exposing racism in the police department did make this a fair use, notwithstanding that Congress has not put anything into Section 107 of the Copyright Act about the need to expose racism. But let's look through another prism at what's going on in these cases, because after all, what Negativland said is, if it is productive and it is not wholesale, that should be fair use. If we go down to about the fourth and fifth case, we see our paradigm realized. For instance, the James Bond. Honda did a very whimsical ad for a car in which there's a suave and debonair spy with a beautiful woman and an evil villain. And lo and behold, MGM says, well, you know what? The teeth from the villain come from Goldfinger, and the eyebrows come from Dr. No, and the expression of the woman comes from Russia with Love. So you have taken various elements from James Bond. Okay. We would expect under the Negativland formulation for this to be fair use, and yet the court held it not to be fair use. Going on to the next page, for instance, towards the bottom of page two, the Dr. Seuss case. Very productive use of Dr. Seuss to write the cat not in the hat in the same anapestic tetrameter, but with rhymes such as one knife, two knife, red wife, red knife, dead wife. And the cat in the hat was wearing a stovepipe hat, but looked like O.J. Simpson. And the claim was, this is a parody. It's taking the original, and it's exceeding the Seussian imagination. And the court said that's mere post-fact literary rationalization. Like, I'd like to know about the Two Live Crew case. That was not post-hoc literary characterization. In any event, the court said, no, that's not fair use. Okay, so we have no pattern yet. Let's look down to the next case, Kulik Photography. Also out of the O.J. Simpson case, there happened to be a copyrighted photograph introduced into evidence and therefore was shown all over the nation. Copyright infringement suit by the proprietor of the photograph. Court said, come on, you used it in court. That is not an example of unfair use. That's fair, notwithstanding that the statute contains nothing overtly about fair, about use in a court case. On page three, the fourth one down, another court case. Two parties to a trademark infringement case. One party has a survey. The other party just uses that same survey in the same piece of litigation. They didn't pay for it, but they used it. Okay, so you didn't pay for it. Surely that's not fair use, and was made for the litigation, used in the litigation. Okay, court said, well, that is fair use. So maybe there's a blanket rule, as long as you use it in a court case, it's fair use. But we look down at page four to the penultimate decision, Images Audio versus Perini, a party to an arbitration, a construction arbitration, used in the arbitration photographs of the subject building, and the court said that's not fair use. After all, it wasn't paid for. I'm trying to illustrate that it's very difficult to get a trend here on exactly what's going on. I'll end, although we could spend hours on this chart, I'll end back on page three, right below the Lucent case about trademark. Two cases, Columbia Pictures versus Miramax, Leibowitz versus Paramount Pictures. both of them involving a poster for a movie, a parody poster for a movie. First, you have Men in Black with two guys with oversized weapons, and Michael Moore portrays himself all in black with an oversized microphone, being an investigative reporter. That's not fair use. Then you have Demi Moore pregnant on this cover of Vanity Fair. So Paramount says, great, we're going to take someone who looks exactly like Demi Moore, naked and pregnant, but put Leslie Nielsen's face on for Naked Gun 33 and a third, do this march. Court says, that is fair. Now, what's the difference? That Michael Moore is a kind of cloying and obnoxious, but Leslie Nielsen is funny? Is that what's going on in these cases? And how do we advise, yeah, right, I think so too. How do we advise a client? Can I get the screen? I'll give you a real case that I have that just came to me, and the client that brought this to me has given me permission to go ahead and display this image. On March 4th, 1940, the Nazi troops had already taken over in the east of Europe, in Czechoslovakia and in Poland, but in the west of Europe, there was still calm, or relative. There was a great deal of worry, but there was still calm. A Jewish girl named Betty Penny Scherder had a slumber party to which she invited her friends. One of her friends was a young girl named Anne Frank. In the book that Henny had, she asked all of her friends to sign one page as a keepsake. Young Anne Frank took some stickers, copyrighted by someone else, out of her sticker book, and affixed them to Henny's book. And then she also wrote, Best to Henny, Dear Henny. And translating very loosely from the Dutch, it's nothing much that I can offer you. It's a little nothing much I can offer you. Pluck roses on earth. I'm forget me not, and forget me not. The book that Henny had is in the possession of the Simon Wiesenthal Center in Los Angeles, California. What you see has never been published and probably never been publicly displayed. I go with reckless abandon where David Lange declined to go. There is a foundation in Switzerland that owns the copyright to this book by a grant from Anne Frank's sole survivor, namely her father. And that foundation has explicitly told the Simon Wiesenthal Center not to exploit this work. So what's the status? Well, it's very easy. It's an extremely easy copyright case. Judgment for the plaintiff, this is not fair use. I'll go through the four factors. Purpose and character of the use, Wiesenthal Center is going to sell photographs of this, sell postcards of this, commercial use. Nature of the work, it's not a factual compilation, it's a very inspired poem. Amount, they're capping 100%. Effect on the market, they're going to destroy the Swiss Foundation's market for postcards. So therefore, all four factors favor the plaintiff, right? Well, once again, appropriating from David Lange, the ability to be totally unconcerned with any case precedent that has been decided, I'll run through the four factors again, recursively, going backwards. Fourth factor, effect on the potential market. My colleague at UCLA, Justin Hughes, has developed an interesting way of looking at the fair use doctrine without giving undue credit to copyright owners whose terms may get extended again and again. So listen up, Larry Lessig. And it is as follows. You should look at the effect of the market over time. So therefore, if there's a usage of Mickey Mouse today that has no effect on the usage of Mickey Mouse from 1928 through 2001, the only effect it can have on the potential market is for the future market, which is a much smaller effect. Now, this work would have been in the public domain in 1995, extended to 2000 percentage before, but the statute does not say percent, it says amount. The amount is 18 words. And if we get rid of best to Henny, it's down to 16 words. So the amount is tiny, it's minuscule. It highly favors the defendant in this case. What about the nature of the work? I forgot to tell you on behalf of the plaintiff. This is an unpublished work that's the prime children of the second factor. Okay, I'm going to turn that around as well. In her paper, Pam Samuelson contrasts a grocery list that she calls detritus against a gem like a Mozart symphony. This work challenges our notion of what it is. I think it's a little gem, but it is something that was not destined for publication. It is no more dear to the copyright core than a ransom note, as Judge LaValle points out, that is technically subject to copyright protection, but was not written because of the incentive to, pr- to promote the progress of science and the useful arts. So the second factor massively favors the defendant in this case. And going back to the first factor, purpose and nature of the use, I can do no better than to quote the author of the work, Anne Frank, "Pluck roses on earth and forget me not." Who is it that's trying to forget me not? It's the defendant, the party who's trying to publish Anne's work to the world. This case is actually the inverse of the Dead Sea Scrolls case for those who followed it, because instead of the owner of the one artifact trying to use copyright law to keep the world out, it's the one owner of the one artifact who's trying to get it out and is being hit by copyright in return. Okay, so all four factors I've concluded in my new non-precedential mode massively favor the defendant, and I will now rule that it is fair use. How much time am I doing on time? How much more time do I have?
Why don't you, if you can, give them a chance to interact?
Okay, I'll take 60 seconds to sum up. I recommend reading David Lange's foundational paper because it's most intriguing. It takes off on what Lloyd Weinreb said, namely, fair is fair. And I think if you look at what motivates courts, Leslie Nielsen's funny, racism is bad. Court proceedings should be privileged unless maybe they're not privileged. There's an inchoate sense of fair is fair in each of those instances. Unfortunately, both Lloyd Weinreb and David Lange have said way too much, because the summary of the fair use doctrine is fair is fair, and beyond that, we cannot say. Okay, I think I can handle them. Yes, sir.
This was wonderful, very interesting, but I can't afford to hire David Nimmer.
Oh, don't worry, I'm giving them pro bono advice, and I assure you they're getting every bit that they're paying for.
And as I look at your chart and listen to your discussion, it actually does seem as though, although often people who favor the public domain want to say the wonderful genius of the Section 107 is the multiplicity of its factors and the fact you can't pin any one of them and look at this case and that case, it really looks fairly bad for the kinds of creators who might create on the internet, because as I listen to you, as you're running through the cases, the ones I didn't know, I couldn't predict the outcome. And as you pointed out, there's no consistent line in here. Does this lead you to believe that we actually do need something that a lot of the public domain fair use devotees have said we didn't need, namely a bright line rule for fair use, perhaps of the kind that Marx suggests?
Okay, well, changing fair use into a bright line rule would, of course, be taking it out of the transubstantiation category and putting it into the flossing category. It's something that I think can never happen because we will never be able to express what it is that we mean by fair use. Now, I shouldn't say it can never happen. I'm sure someone here could write a computer program that factors in the social utility, the amount of the appropriation, how creative a work it is, and could give you an answer in every case. And if the courts wanted to adopt that, we would have 100% predictability. So it could be done. I guess when I say it can never happen, I'm making a normative statement that it should never happen. What Mark Hosler said, the single most important thing that he said in terms of his defenses for everything that he flagrantly and deliciously put on the screen was, quote, "We have no money." That was his best defense. And in fact, I view it as an insuperable defense. Because in order to file a lawsuit alleging unfair use, you have to look, as every lawyer does, at the precedent. Fair use is unique in that it's gone more than any other copyright doctrine to the US Supreme Court. Every single time it has gone there, there was a decision by the district court, reversed by the circuit court, reversed by the Supreme Court, almost always with a dissent at the Supreme Court level, although not always. If there is anything that's less predictable than that in the law, I haven't run across it. Meaning both defendants and plaintiffs have to realize we are simply taking a crapshoot. If it's a very well-heeled defendant suing a Negativland, that's a very, very, very bad, very bad business proposition. So I don't view the fair use doctrine as being as grievous for those appropriation artists as do you. Yes.
Yeah, I think one of the most important statutory aspects of fair use is not in the fair use statute at all. And it may be very telling about how we can be creative in defining this concept. over in this statutory damages section is some limited protection for those of us who are in nonprofit educational world to give us protection from the statutory damages and hence the motivation for parties to settle out this case instead of looking at real dollars and real threats and real lawsuits. But it's a protection if we've done our homework in advance. If we believe, which is purely subjective, we can all believe what we want, believe what we did was fair use, but then there's an objective element too, that we have reasonable grounds for that belief. So you have, assuming we don't change section 107 on fair use, you have your four-factor test, which can be interpreted in a wide variety of ways, as we now know. You do your homework before you push the buttons and make your copies, make your uses, and you come to the conclusion that you believe it's fair use, you have your reasonable grounds for the belief, and then you have some protection from other consequences. So basic remedies like an injunction can still prevail, but at least you're not going to face the large dollars.
Okay, good.
You can begin to redefine what the meaning of infringement is.
You know what? I have to disagree with you there, although it's a very interesting proposition. There are three levels of mental state. There's willful infringement, there's innocent infringement, and then there's, for want of a better word, knowing infringement. A willful infringer, without pointing to anyone here, is a party who simply takes stuff and says, I don't care if it's protected or not. An innocent infringer who has a good faith basis for believing that the law protects them. Knowing infringer is, you know, you have an argument, it might be a good argument, it might be a bad argument, you ultimately lose. If the defense of the university is, we are an ISP and we fall within the safe harbor of Section 512 of the Copyright Act because all the factors are satisfied, and it turns out one of those factors is not satisfied, you're an innocent infringer. On the other hand, if you're a university and you say, well, we think it's fair use, and we're darn convinced ourselves that it's fair use, and the court finds that it's not fair use, it's a jury question, because the question of statutory damages, since Feltner is for juries, I have no confidence whatsoever that the jury is going to parse the question so finely as to say it's not fair use, but we think that you held a good faith belief subjectively that it was fair use, which was objectively reasonable, although wrong, and therefore we're going to mitigate statutory damages.
There are a couple of problems with your reaction. And
only a couple? I'm happy.
and one of them is that as a practical matter, it'll never get to the jury under those circumstances. That as a practical matter, this is the case where you see if you did your homework, we're going to set this thing up, and it's an immediate call, and so on. And so that's, I think, the paramount difference between one situation and another.
If the plaintiff's willing to settle. Okay, yes. So one more question, or is that it?
One more.
Or if that's it,
one more.
Yes.
I'm curious to, if you can fit it in here, on your position as to whether there's an independent First Amendment defense to copyright infringement, which is an issue a lot of us anticipate to see litigated more often. And there was the D.C. Circuit Judge Ginsburg sort of making a flat statement reading Harper to say First Amendment equals fair use. And so looking at your chart, is this also what the First Amendment means in your view?
Okay. No, this chart is reductionist in the extreme, and it does not include 100 things. It does not include the First Amendment. I'll give you my view as to whether there is a separate First Amendment defense. The U.S. Supreme Court has said that the same framers who made the First Amendment also passed the first copyright statute, and therefore, in the normal course of events, the fair use doctrine of copyright law embodies First Amendment concern. And then it added a citation to a section of a treatise, which section talks about the need of the First Amendment to trump copyright in certain events, and the discussion there is about the My Lai photographs, whose effect would not be appreciated through any means other than reproduction of the photographs. Given the citation by the Supreme Court as authority for its proposition was to that section of the treatise, I would conclude that in certain circumstances there is a First Amendment defense.
Thank you very much.
That's the kind of thing that when I'm talking to people, I want to be able to sort of go,
take it and run with it.
How long did it, but you already know, you're so well versed in this.
Hello.
I think the most pressing question that we have before us today is, why am I here? Seemed like a good idea at the time. But the truth is that David Lange has a silver tongue, as you've all heard, and he persuaded me to come to lend some balance, and I will try and do that, but I think, unfortunately, you're going to find that we're not always going to be disagreeing on a lot of things. On the most recent fair use issues, for example, I'm described in some of the programs as an industry representative. The industry really has no view on this. There are copyright owners on every side of these battles. So don't think that this is something where it's quite clear that copyright owners or the record labels, for example, are knee-jerk protectionists on this sort of thing. They're the ones who get in trouble when somebody samples. So they want fair use right to sampling just as much as they want to sometimes protect their rights when somebody else samples against them. So it's a very tough issue. And I don't think the artists' community is any different. I don't remember the early sampling cases, but if I recall, it started with artists, not with labels. It was artists who were really bringing those cases. Hey, man, that was my riff. And the fact
is, with De La Soul.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you. So the artist community can be just as proprietary as the corporate greedy labels, media moguls, and everybody else. So we shouldn't simplify these issues and think that fair use on the one hand and protection on the other is the difference between creator and corporate owner. So we should be careful about that. Although I'm not an industry representative on these issues, I will try and give you some perspective of where the industry stands and what it thinks about a lot of the issues that you've got. And because of the issues that have been raised about public domain and so on and so forth, I thought I should at least deal with the canard that record companies, for example, are really not interested in the internet, that they really want to close it down, they want to close down competition on the internet, they just want to go back to a world of CDs where they can just make their dinosaur profits. And that just is not the reality. You've got to understand that for the last 50 years, record companies have never dealt directly with their consumers. They deal through intermediaries. They sell their product through retailers. They market their products through radio stations. They've never had a one-to-one connection. We've discovered a long time ago that the reason that the next album of a band doesn't sell is that no one knew it came out. Well, all of a sudden, you have an opportunity, if you know who's actually buying your products, to send them an email letting them know that the band has come out with a new album, or that, you know, the band is touring in your city, or that there's some other artist like that band that you might enjoy. So there are so many opportunities. You can email samples from the new album. The promotional opportunities of the internet are enormous. But then, of course, comes the new delivery mechanisms. The notion of downloading music directly to consumers day or night changes completely the way that the business can operate. It opens up the marketplace. You know, the big labels have been a mass market phenomenon, no question about it. They need to sell a lot of discs in order to make the investment worthwhile. But if you have the internet, being able to find those customers, being able to find the niche audience for the smaller artist, then suddenly you can make a living off small artists as well as big artists, because you can find the fans wherever they are in the country. And it becomes commercially feasible to expand a small band into a large band just because of the internet. Then there's the catalog. All that music that has been sitting back in dusty vaults, unusable, because it just didn't make economic sense to press it, warehouse it, ship it, you know, one or two albums to thousands and thousands of record stores around the country. Well, all of a sudden, all of that becomes available again and becomes a source of revenue for labels and for artists. You can start changing the packaging of your music. we've been selling CDs. They all have 12 or 13 songs or whatever. Well, now you can sell singles, 2, 3, 5, all sorts of different opportunities, compilations. And what kind of download are you going to do? It could be a permanent download where it's just like selling a CD, but it could also be a temporary download. It could be something where you don't get it forever, but it's limited in time. You have a party on Saturday night, you can rent 1,000 songs that will be available in your house over the weekend, and all of a sudden you've got an entirely new kind of transaction between labels and consumers. We've had, really, when you think about it, such a limited offering in terms of the way that we've been able to sell our product. You know, you just put it on discs, and either it sells or it doesn't, and that's it. All of that changes. And then there's streaming. You know, you have real-time transmission of music, so it can be listened to while it's being retransmitted, or you can, and the way that you can do that streaming would be everything from artist channels to genre channels to music on demand, being able to pick exactly what you want to hear when you want to hear it. And you can pay for it by the listen, you could pay for it by the song, or you can do the all-you-can-eat subscription models that everybody's been thinking about in terms of these new opportunities. And you might be able to get that for free if you want to pay, if you want to listen to ads, or think about the ability to, when you hear something you like, be able to click on the buy button and get it downloaded to you right away. And then when wireless actually comes along and all of a sudden you're buying a copy for the server in your basement that serves up the entire house, I think people are going to begin to consume music in entirely new ways. Now, why do I mention all of this? It's not just to make clear that there are really enormous opportunities presented by the internet and that labels have every reason to pursue those opportunities, but also to remind you of the benefits of digital delivery. They are going to expand consumer choice. We're going to have an extraordinary array of new transactions between creators and consumers. And I do say creators, not just the labels, because creators can do this themselves if they want. There's going to be no limit here on who's going to own the rights and be able to deliver this stuff. Everybody will have equal access to the internet. But here's the real point, and that is that security is the other side of these new business opportunities. Without security, a lot of those new consumer offerings just won't be possible. If you can email a song to somebody to expose somebody to a new band, and that email then becomes permanent, that is that you can keep the song without it timing out, and people aren't going to use that new promotional vehicle. If you can rent 1,000 songs for a weekend, but come Monday, it's still there for you to keep forever, that model disappears. If somebody's going to invest the time and money to start a new subscription service, but you can't control access, it doesn't work. So security is just not the enemy of fair use and the public domain, any more than security guards are the enemy of shopping. I just think that we have to begin to look at this in a little bit different way. Now, you're undoubtedly going to ask, you know, what about the impact of technical security measures on reasonable and established instances of fair use? And I completely agree that these are reasonable issues. Excerpting, criticism, collage. I wonder, frankly, why that question is so urgent right now, because these issues weren't raised when premium cable began scrambling. Nobody was complaining that that meant the end of fair use for motion pictures. People accepted it as a reasonable means of ensuring that there was going to be a limitation on access. But it is a question that's very much in the public right now, and I think it's a question that remains to be answered over time because the answer just isn't clear yet. We're all still finding our way. I have no doubt that fair use interests will be fully protected. We're in a transition now, and I think we will be for years to come, because let's face it, the digital revolution is really a digital evolution. This is going to take a long time to move from one market to another. It's one of the reasons that labels have to be very careful about how they do this. Their core business still is the sale of physical product. 99% of their stuff is sold in physical product. they can't cannibalize and destroy that sales base by completely revaluing the proposition on the internet in a way that destroys the retailer. But CDs are going to be around for a long time to come, as are cassettes, as are print copies and journal copies and all the kinds of things by which all this stuff will continue to be available. And it makes you wonder why there would be, therefore, a limitation on fair use if, in fact, these other means of providing the content are available. The other point, of course, is that IP owners have never made any money by locking up their content. If they don't make it available, they don't earn any revenues. And believe it or not, I actually have faith in future technical measures. I think that a lot of the things that people are talking about are going to enable all kinds of fair use implementations that will make sure that all sorts of personal uses will be preserved while you'll be able to at least prevent the internet distribution problem that has really plagued the industry. And I think that all of that is in the future and coming. The other thing, of course, is how do you offer all these opportunities? How do you justify the investment in these opportunities if you're competing with free? How do you deal with this if you're dealing not just with people, individuals taking stuff, but businesses that are financed by venture capitalists for the purpose of giving away other people's property? In other words, how can you not sue Napster? If you can't stand for the proposition that the wholesale appropriation is infringement, then what's left? And I think it's important to distinguish in David Lange's article from appropriation art versus appropriation. And a lot of what we've been talking about today has been appropriation art. And I think the test for appropriation art necessarily has to be completely different from that of wholesale appropriation. We have attempted to really focus on those businesses. We have not gone after consumers. And believe me, we are well aware of the fact that by bringing a lawsuit against Napster, you are pissing off the very people who are your best customers. Believe me, we are aware of that. But what do? You take the risk of pissing them off and allowing businesses to... Do you realize that Napster was being offered for $2 billion? It was a $13 million investment by the venture capital firm, and they were about to turn it around for a $2 billion investment. Fortunately, some people thought there were some legal issues here and maybe they shouldn't make the investment. But the fact is that people were going to capitalize on giving away other people's property. That just has to have profound implications for the way that the intellectual property community can operate in the future. We have also attempted to be very balanced in the way that we deal with asking others to help. We have not asked ISPs, for example, to deal with to take down consumers who are using file sharing networks or anything like that. You have heard that a bunch of people in the entertainment industry have been doing that. We have not, because we recognize that it would just be unseemly to say that just because some 10-year-old kid is using Nutella in his bedroom, that that household should lose internet access. Obviously, there are a lot of things that have to be done here to figure out how to find this balance. We really don't know yet how all that will be worked out. But this is a long-term proposition. We are just at the beginning of this digital revolution. And I think we're going to be in this together for the long term. So I say, let's wait and see, let's work, let's dialogue, and let's try and find the common ground that actually advances everybody's interests as we go forward.
That you can see some prospect that technical mechanisms could guarantee fair use. And we've just heard from David Nimmer what an astonishingly complex and unpredictable notion of fair use is. Can you give us any idea what you have in mind here? Because I haven't the slightest idea what might possibly guarantee fair use in that way.
I think that's a fair question. And let me comment on that, the general point about fair use. I completely agree with David Lange that the existing fair use regime is a nightmare. I mean, it is an unfortunate situation that you have to be a copyright lawyer to even begin to think through whether something might be a fair use analysis, and even then you have no idea what a court is actually going to decide. And it is unfortunate, therefore, that fair use determinations are really left to the legal circles and the judges rather than more clearly identified for the people who actually want to take advantage of it. That doesn't mean that I agree with everything in David's paper about what that new test should be, and frankly, I thought that David's paper still left other questions, which is, you know, at what point was this really considered a transformative use and so on and so forth, because one thing that we've learned over the last few years, I assure you, is that there are any number of people willing to push the envelope of all the legal issues that are out there, and that no matter what kind of copyright exception might be put forward, no matter how well-intentioned, it will be taken to its extreme in defense of unreasonable positions. And I think that Mark pushing the envelope is a rather different type of issue, because that is, at least to me, truly transformative art, which raises an entirely different set of questions than the wholesale appropriation that we've been facing on the internet. So, how do you do fair use in that context? I can't deal with that issue in terms of collages and so on and so forth, although, as I said, there's no doubt in my mind that there are always going to be ways. You didn't have to worry about getting the DVD version of Little Mermaid, which is encrypted, in order to make your stuff. There were plenty of opportunities for you to get Little Mermaid in many different ways, so you'd be able to exercise any fair use privilege you may have. But in addition, you can actually, for example, if you want owners, if you want people who purchase a piece of music to be able to use it for personal devices and so on and so forth, but not be able to put it up on the internet, there would be ways to tether it to either a machine or to a series of machines in a household. You're shaking your head, but why do you think that these technologies are not possible?
I mean, that would be predicated on something like SSSCF. I mean, because that sort of hardware platform tying is only possible if you have that sort of strong authentication bound to the hardware.
It would be great if there actually was going to be a magic bullet that did all that, but the reality is that that's not going to happen. Let's be realistic. We spent many years in SDMI, the Secure Digital Music Initiative, trying to establish a common ground in order to find ways to allow personal use, but not internet piracy. And although there were definitely differences between the content industries and the CE and IT industries and all the other industries in terms of what their objectives were, we were actually able to find common ground. We really were. What we couldn't find was the technology. We couldn't find a technology that actually would do the trick, that was actually going to be responsive to the different needs of the different communities. That's one of the reasons why there's no magic bullet. The IT needs, a computer can have a processor that can do identification systems and so on that requires incredible processing power. But when you try and put that same thing on a wireless cell phone, and you think of what the impact would be on the battery life of that if you use the same technology, it becomes unavailable as a technology. So we just couldn't find that common technology or one that was sufficiently robust to actually make a difference. It just wasn't going to be worth the effort. Yes? Okay. You pick one.
How does this music become your property? Good question.
I'm sorry, I don't understand the question. What do you mean, how does music become your property?
I think it's quite straightforward. How does this music become your property?
Who's me?
Well, you talk about we, so I'm assuming the recording industry. How does it become your property?
By contracts with artists.
Not unfair bargaining contracts.
They're standard.
I'd be happy to address that issue if you like. It's certainly far afield from the subject of fair use. But, you know, it's up to you as to whether you want to spend the time on it.
It's actually up to you. If you're willing to take this on for a few more minutes, we can do that. But I think maybe we ought to close this off in another couple of minutes.
couple of 3 minutes and let Rosemary have a chance.
Okay. There's definitely issues about bargaining relationships between artists and labels, no question about it. It's received a lot of press, will continue to receive a lot of press. We can try and legislate away the economics of a marketplace, but the fact of the matter is, new artists have very little bargaining power. Established artists have an unbelievable amount of bargaining power. Established artists can get unbelievable advances. New artists get lower advances. The whole economics of this industry is unusual. I've found that the entertainment industry tends to be bound with its culture. There are certain ways that things develop, and the lawyers on both sides have an established way of doing something. They simply add to contracts, they never change them. So, for example, you have deductions that were packaging deductions that were started when things were broken, and the royalty rates were established on that basis, and that system just continues. Now, you could do away with a lot of that stuff and just have a lower royalty rate, but nobody wants it. The artist doesn't want it, the manager doesn't want it, the lawyer for the artist doesn't want it, because then it looks like they didn't get a good deal. So the systems perpetuate themselves. But a lot of the system of this industry is based on advances. You pay as much money, an artist will get as much money up front as possible, because that way the artist has transferred the risk of failure to the record company. Alan Grubman once said that if an artist of mine ever receives a dime in royalties, I have failed. I think that reflects the way that the system works in terms of negotiating. It's just the way, it's just the reality of the economics of the business.
I think we'll stop here just for the moment. Thanks, Cary, very much.
Thanks.
Okay, thank you. I'm very glad to be here for a number of reasons, and I've been incredibly enriched and edified by the creative wealth of papers and positions we've been exposed to, particularly David Lange's critical transformative appropriations paper. Now, I come to you today as a Canadian and as an anthropologist, as well as a legal scholar who's had a longstanding interest in the intersection of intellectual property, creative appropriation, and cultural expression. And most recently, my work has been in with respect to critical transformative usages of trademark on the internet and how that's creating new moral economies and new forms of corporate accountability. So I, too, can be fun and funky, but today I'm more convinced about the importance of being earnest. First of all, let me say that I am immensely hopeful about the project of defining the cultural public domain. The caveats and reservations I'm going to offer here should be taken as footnotes designed to open up the discussion so that the public domain might serve a wider set of political aspirations. I'm going to make three points, and first I'm going to make them bluntly. First, that a cultural public domain framed entirely by American legal principles without consideration of the legal circumstances in which most of the world's peoples find themselves runs the danger of appearing to be both self-serving and imperialist. Second, to the extent that we are discussing the cultural public domain, we need to recognize a wider range of activities than those that will serve the needs of Western authors. And third, the continuing existence of cultural diversity that sustains a vibrant cultural public domain will require an ongoing dialogue across and between cultural traditions. And like Cary, I do believe that there are appropriations and there are appropriations. We have to make some distinctions. Now, I don't think it's at all surprising, of course, in a gathering of academics and artists in the United States, the discussion of the public domain tends to concentrate upon issues of fair use and First Amendment. The obvious exceptions here being the scholarly work on common property regimes, which actually I think is an incredibly fruitful area to explore, and I'll say a bit more about that later. But I do think it's important to keep in mind that intellectual property rights are international human rights, as are individual rights of access to the public domain, as are, as well, collective rights to maintain the cultural integrity of peoples and rights of peoples to participate in decisions affecting the use of their cultural heritage. Now, I say this because I think the international human rights framework provides a rich and very fertile source of legal resources with which to think about limitations to intellectual property, as well as principles for delineating the interests that might be served by the public domain based on wider conceptions of social justice. Now, to the extent that the United States, along with Haiti, has never signed the International Covenant on Social, Cultural, and Economic Rights, it's not surprising that it tends to be overlooked in U.S. Conferences. But the U.S. is isolated to this extent. And these rights are accepted, even occasionally in U.S. courts, as part of international customary law and as providing the normative framework through which national laws should be interpreted. Now, I think we face the very real possibility that if we face too exclusively on concepts of fair use and the jurisprudence interpreting the intersection of copyright, patent, and the First Amendment, we are concerning ourselves with local ordinances in a world of global interconnections, increasingly governed by neoliberal trade regimes, which have a tendency to narrow the realms of their applicability. I do not need to mention that the First Amendment is a remarkable privilege, and that many peoples in the world, even those living in putative democracies, do not live in societies where free speech is recognized as an overarching value. Even those who, like myself, who live in countries that do enjoy a constitutional right to freedom of expression, generally face a judicial system that is unwilling to recognize that the exercise of intellectual property rights could ever be considered a threat to freedom of expression. Intellectual property rights have trumped in every case in which the issue has been considered, be it copyright, trademark, or patent. And now, a survey of this issue has yet to be done, but I think it dearly needs to be done, but I would venture that this is likely the case in most Commonwealth jurisdictions, and as well as those other states, now members of the World Trade Organization, who do, in fact, have free speech rights. Now, one might hope that U.S. jurisprudence would serve as an example to these foreign courts having to grapple with such issues, but the Canadian experience suggests quite the opposite. Your tradition is unique. Now, the situation with respect to fair use is even more dire. When Canada, for example, was in the process of considering legislative copyright amendments in order to comply with NAFTA and the TRIPS agreement, our legislators were greatly assisted by U.S. industrial intellectual property rights holders, who were the most organized and effective lobbyists on the scene, as they have been elsewhere. They argued, quite persuasively, that Canada had no need for a fair use provision. Why would we need a fair use provision to replace our incredibly narrow fair dealing clause, which, by the way, prohibits any balancing of interests? There are four factors you can, they're not even four factors you consider. There are four kinds of uses, very precisely delineated, that are fair, all others are not. In fact, at the same time, we saw a simultaneous proliferation of collecting societies, all with nicely patriotic names. The Canadian Broadcasting Collective, for instance, represents U.S. networks and the entertainment wing of American sports teams. There were dozens of these formed, and these were designed to create the conditions under which it became reasonable to assert that if the use of a work can be licensed with minimal transaction costs, there was no dealing with a work that should be considered fair. Now, all unlicensed usages were henceforth to be considered presumptively unfair. Now, there's little reason to think that the Canadian experience is unique. U.S. corporate interests, although sometimes through other international organizations like the World Intellectual Property Organization, and it has been alleged the World Bank and the IMF, have an economic interest, I would suggest, in isolating the United States and its fair use provisions. So I'm going to suggest that however robust we try to ensure that these become, we also face the possibility that they are endangered. They will no doubt at some point be challenged as illegitimate trade barriers. Is this a paranoid vision? Ruth Ghana Okaji has argued that the U.S. fair use provision could easily be interpreted as impermissible under a strict reading of TRIPS. And she goes at least some distance to provide an analytical framework that might be used to counter such a determination. And let me suggest that it's at that area that work, a lot more work needs to be done. But to the extent that the World Trade Organization is now opening itself up to global civil society organizations and has been told by the International Human Rights Commission, for what it's worth, that its activities are subject to international human rights norms, then I suggest that we will be missing out on a valuable and necessary political opportunity if we continue to consider the public domain only through the lens of national and parochial legal categories, rather than through a body of international law which has the allegiance, in principle if not always in practice, of a far wider community of nations. Now, my second point has to do with the ethics of the cultural public domain and the nature of the culture that informs it. Now, back in 1993, when many of us were first considering the dangers posed by the reckless expansion of intellectual property rights, many of us, some of whom are in this room, Jamie Boyle, Pamela Samuelson, Mark Rose, and myself, drafted something called the Bellagio Declaration. Now, at this point, our political goals were somewhat wider than simply protecting rights of access to cultural forms. Although, and here I quote, in general, we favor increased recognition and protection of the public domain. We call on the international community to expand the public domain through expansive application of concepts of fair use, compulsory licensing, and narrow initial coverage of property rights in the first place. But since existing author-focused regimes are blind to the interests of non-authorial producers, as well as to the importance of the commons, the main exception to this expansion of the public domain should be in favor of those who have been excluded by the authorial biases of current law. Thus, we advocated consideration of sui generis and or neighboring rights regimes to protect works of cultural heritage, folklore, and traditional environmental knowledge. Now, the ecosystem knowledge of indigenous peoples and those whose traditional cultural knowledge of local ecosystems nurtures the ongoing production of biological diversity upon which modern agriculture and the world's food security depends has since this time become a major issue within the United Nations. I come at this because I've been privileged to work with the indigenous caucus of several UN working groups under the Convention on Biological Diversity and at several WIPO meetings. And what becomes quite evident is that and I know that Americans, when they think indigenous, they think Indians. The way indigenous is defined internationally is very wide, and it potentially incorporates most peoples living in any kind of subsistence-based economies, that is, the world's peasants. What becomes clear at these meetings is that for many people, that is, those people whose creative efforts have for centuries been considered the common heritage of humankind, the public domain is understood to be a concept that justifies their ongoing impoverishment. It is a term which they hear as legitimating the appropriation of cultural forms that are seen as mere resources, data, raw material for the works of those recognized as Western authors. They see it, in short, as a zone for expropriation that denies them their membership as peoples in the world of nations and respect as creators in their own right. Now, I would hope that these people are taken into account when we consider activities of appropriation, that the idea of a cultural public domain considers our responsibilities as well as our freedoms, that recognizes that freedom is not mere license, and that liberties are not libertarian, and that acts of appropriation be not only critical, creative, transformative, but ethical, attentive to the conditions in which we come to have access to cultural resources and their meanings in the life worlds of others. The demands of indigenous peoples and traditional communities, however, is not simply for compensation, although a liability rule regime such as Jerry Reichman has proposed in the Green Tulips article would accomplish major benefits in this area, and the limited commons produced last week in the International Undertaking on Plant Genetic Resources is something I think we all should celebrate if it doesn't get taken away by the United States getting rid of Section 27.3b and the right to exempt from patents, life forms. But in any case, the demand here is not simply for compensation, although I think that many forms of compensation are necessary and desirable, but for recognition as peoples and as partners in the preservation of cultural diversity to serve longer-term human objectives. Now, in the next 50 years, it's estimated that we will lose about 4,000 of the remaining 5 to 6,000 human languages. And thus the cultural knowledge that these languages embody. These people who speak these languages are under threat. Their livelihoods are imperiled as they are displaced by ancestral lands, mining, timber companies, modern agriculture, and pushed into urban economies that cannot support them. The biological diversity they nourish precisely through their distinctive cultural knowledge of local ecologies. So I think the environmental metaphor that Jamie Boyle suggests we adopt when considering the politics of protecting the informational commons is apt. But it's important to remember that the concept of ecology is not simply one of relationships between parts of a natural world or amongst social actors, but entertains as well cosmologies that link people and environments with ancestral spirits, animals, and obligations to future generations. The cultural survival of peoples, another recognized human right, will require that our appropriations do not involve depredations or desecrations. Certain takings of cultural goods do create cultural, social, and political harms to peoples, for whom cultural forms are somewhat more tightly interwoven with forms of subsistence in local life worlds. For this reason, respect for limited common property regimes and the limited common property regimes developed by others, as Carol Rose has suggested, should not be overlooked in the public domain we seek to recognize. Indeed, the UN Environment Development Programs, as well as the UN Commission on the Protection of the Rights of Minorities, as well as the Convention on Biological Diversity, and the Working Group on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples, have all denounced the relentless expansion of industrial intellectual property rights as one of the greatest threats to development in the planet. And they have all, along with WIPO, who may only be giving lip service to the idea, proposed that indigenous customary law be considered a viable regime for governance, as well as a possible source of legal resources to inform modern legal regimes, model and modern legal regimes at the international level. So this public domain, however, need not be considered one in which we merely acknowledge closed local fiefdoms over cultural resources, but might also be considered as spaces, as providing spaces of opportunity for cross-cultural dialogue. And I'm going to just end with two examples. The first is partially hypothetical, mainly because I can't remember enough of the details. The second is actual. Now, several years ago, someone's probably going to know all the details and therefore make it much more real. Several years ago, a band developed a musical composition that contained, amongst other things, a sample of a recording of the music of an indigenous tribe resident in Taiwan. Now, as music which was neither individually authored nor fixed in material form, it does not attract copyright protection. It was first recorded by a visiting researcher for what local people, or at least their representatives, were told was for purely archival purposes. Now, how this music became available to this band and the extent to which its appropriation involved the breach of a fiduciary obligation is one question that might be posed here. And certainly, the existence of a neighboring rights regime that would enable collectives to prohibit unauthorized fixation, sort of a collective version of performers' rights, and to prohibit unauthorized uses of authorized fixations of traditional works, would go some way to give these people some leverage. But I think the leverage they would choose is not so much one of a royalty fee, so much as the political opportunity it might provide. Few people even know there are any indigenous peoples in Taiwan, and neither Taiwan nor China recognizes their existence or that their languages and traditions are endangered. There will be no more of this music to sample from in a few years' time. Can our arts of appropriation be practiced so as to further the maintenance or stem the ongoing destruction of the cultural diversity? Second example, this is a headline from last week. Maori concerned over misrepresentation of their culture. Representatives of the Maori wrote a letter to complaint to the Lego company about the content of its Bionicle game, which used Maori words and historical figures as characters mixed up with words and mythical figures from Easter Island and Polynesian cultures. Maori lawyers complained to Lego, but they made it clear that their intent was not to remove all representations of Maori culture from the international toy market. Rather, they objected to the fantastic hybridization of cultural traditions that the game affected and the inappropriate use of religious terms referring to healers and spiritual advisors. But in making this point, Maori groups did not simply complain. They offered to engage in a dialogue of reconciliation. Lego sent representatives to New Zealand, and as a consequence of this meeting, Lego are now engaging Maori advisors as consultants in the development of a code of conduct for governing the use of traditional knowledge in the manufacture of toys. The Maori, in turn, will help Lego make contacts with other indigenous peoples, again, not to protect and isolate people's cultures, but to ensure that these mass market goods serve educational as well as entertainment vehicles, which promotes greater recognition for Maoris as people. Now, this is only a single example. Oh, it's not the only one I could have used, but it's not without wider significance. The cultural public domain will ultimately, I hope, be multicultural and dialogic, linking culturally diverse common property regimes through negotiations that cross borders and build bridges. Thanks.
This will be our game. We'll give Rosemary a similar question and answer period as all the other panelists have had. And then after about 5 minutes of that, we'll run out our time, which will end promptly at 5:15 with general questions. But you will understand, meanwhile, that David Nimmer will be leaving at 5:05 to return to the hotel. So, questions?
Cary.
That was really brilliant, and I compliment you on it. The question, I wanted to link something you said with something that Cary said and find the disconnect. Because I thought Cary was trying to be very moderate, and I admired his speech, but the disconnect is there. That is, there is some success at the international level, you've given us some, but there's some others on the fair use regime. If we look at the WIPO copyright treaty as it was negotiated among all the conflicting interests, I happen to think that that was a wonderful treaty, and it provides explicitly for these fair use interests and for these traditional privileged uses, and all one had to do was respect that in the local.
Well, let me address that before Cary does. I know you were, you know, inside parties in those negotiations. I suppose I would try to make that set of circumstances further make my point. Because you're trying to introduce things in terms of sets of legal principles which don't have that much weight outside of the U.S. And so, in fact, had you internationalized the discourse at that point, it would have been easier, in fact, for it to be introduced nationally. Now, you couldn't get it done in the U.S., so, you know, imagine how much harder it is in other national regimes where you don't have that constitutional tradition and you don't have, you know, those principles. You can't just keep appealing to these principles. We've got to find a larger vocabulary of appeal. Cary, I'm sorry. Cary, do you want to respond to that?
I have no idea what you're talking about. So it's going to be very tough to respond. I don't know the specific case that Rosemary is referring to. I have no idea whether it was a label that I know. There are thousands of independent labels. I just have no idea how this fits into the overall structure of these issues.
I tell you what, I have some ideas, so I'll say something. Jerry and I were both there in Geneva when the language is hammered out, and Rosemary has a wonderful vision of having international accords there, but I have to relate my favorite story of what occurred at the diplomatic conference. So the very first, this was the world of copyright, to get together from 120 nations plus to make rules for the internet. Very first motion was European Union, actually the French delegate got up and said, I move that the EU delegate be given block voting for all 16 of us. And Japan objected to that, and the US brokered a compromise, which was passed as the first order of business. The compromise was the EU delegate would indeed be able to cast 16 votes en masse, but only when all 16 national representatives were in the room, meaning if Italy went to make a phone call or Denmark went to the bathroom, it would be 14 votes. So I love that because the internet is the realm of cyberspace, which is the realm of no physical presence. The very first vote was, you have to be in chambre A at the conférence des délégués in order for your vote to count. It was a beautiful moment.
It used to be, it seems to me, that the liberal tradition was about that the best cure for bad speech was more speech. And I think that's changed somewhat, at least in this society, and I sometimes want to the only liberal who remains in that camp, everyone else has gone somewhere else. But my question to you is this, is in the example that you gave about the Maori tribe, is the system that you might be looking to have be something where if that tribe did not like the way that LEGO was handling or appropriating their cultural in part of some kind of a intellectual property scheme, to give them a kind of a veto, a sort of legal cause of action, perhaps to deal with that, and how would that play out in an international scheme that versus a solely American scheme?
First of all, I'm not. I would suggest that under certain interpretations of international legal principles dealing with cultural heritage, they might already have that right. But and certainly. Indigenous peoples have used national legislation, as have many other people, to prohibit this mass media circulation of representations which are found to be offensive or disparaging to them as a people. There's an exemption for that, in fact, in the Trademark Act. The rights of to protect one's cultural heritage, however, are fairly limited. In the sense that it's only those things which you can show are essential to your ongoing survival as a people that you can control the use of. My point was precisely that neither a zone of absolute freedom nor a zone of absolute property are the only possibilities in the world we live in, and that if you exercise a veto power without anyone understanding what kind of harm you've suffered or why you consider yourself to have suffered a harm, you've lost a major opportunity. And fortunately, most indigenous peoples are smart enough to realize that. They are, as I said, much more interested in engaging in dialogue and being treated as people to be talked to rather than people to just be represented for their exotic indicia. So my emphasis is once again not on prohibitions, not on absolute freedoms, but on conversations and enriched understandings across boundaries. Wendy.
A comment and a question. The question is about an aspect of your work I think I'm beginning to understand for the first time. As you know, I'm very reluctant to give strong folkloric rights. As I see your position, which is quite different than that, is based on several things. One is our notion of real politics. If you have strong folkloric rights, you can use it as a lever, you can use it to get jobs for your people, you can use it to get straight story out. But it seems like you're also saying something about the universe of norms in which culture evolves. That is, you seem to be saying, and this follows on from the prior questioner, in the United States we may live in a culture where speech breeds more speech, criticism is great, or as Steve Schiffman says, we have a romance of the iconoclast that we embed in the First Amendment, but that there may be cultures where more speech means destruction.
Certain forms of speech affect certain forms of injury.
All right, but your implication was you might actually have a complete cessation of the music if the tribe could be sampled by Westerners.
Well, I'm trying that to the actual disappearance of those peoples as a people. Their capacity to make that music is tied to a certain spiritual tradition, which is in relationship to a particular ancestral territory. They will continue to make music. It won't be that music. But there is something to be said about, you know, the distinctive qualities of that music. But let me address your wider question as I hear it, which is, of course, international human rights does not provide you with a seamless framework. What it provides you with is a larger group of competing norms. And those norms include some collective rights as well as private rights. And that's what I think has been missing in the conversations with respect to intellectual property.
I see fair use in our country as a collective right. That is, a liberty of speech is very much essential to our way of being, even if it might not be for another nation. And if it's illegal under TRIPS, it makes no difference if fair use is constitutionally mandated. We still have to keep fair use. And if we have to sacrifice a little in terms of trade back and forth, that's just the right we have to pay.
So I hope you would. I hope you'd get those corporate actors to, to agree with you. I don't know what you mean by a collective right to fair use. Collective rights are exercised by collectivities, and that's the kind of right that is recognized as collective in international law. Okay.
You mentioned a rather sensitive issue, and that's the indigenous knowledge already being considered common knowledge or in the public domain, which is sometimes very unfortunate for groups that want to protect it. But since it is considered in the public domain, and as far as patent applications, and if it's in the public domain considered prior art, wouldn't you also agree that that does have some value as far as protecting against biopiracy, pharmaceutical applications on this knowledge that these groups originated?
Well, if the United States, like every other country in the world, would recognize foreign prior art that's not in written form, there would be a lot less biopiracy going on. So I don't really, I do find it a bit of an enormous imposition to expect indigenous peoples all over the world or the NGOs that support them to have to document every bit and piece of their traditional knowledge to keep the USPTO happy. Every other jurisdiction in the world has somehow managed perfectly well to recognize foreign prior art, regardless of whether it's published, as long as it's made public and you can demonstrate that later on in the day, that should be sufficient. So I was at the access and benefit sharing meetings of the Convention on Biological Diversity 2 weeks ago in Bonn, and the U.S. national delegate is a lawyer from the USPTO, and they were simply adamant that this was just natural and merely efficient. How could they possibly do their jobs unless everything was available in a form that was fully transparent to them as information? This is creating a lot of difficulties for people. It's also creating some new opportunities. But what I fear is what is going to happen is that more and more of this indigenous knowledge is going to be documented and held as in trade secret status.
We have sworn a mighty oath.
Yes, we did.
That we would not exceed our time on any of these
And
matters.
We have to open this up to a bigger conversation.
And I think that, as a matter of fact, we have about four more minutes, and we will not exceed the additional 4 minutes. So you may ask any question of any member of the panel you like, and when that 4 minutes is up, we'll leave. Joe, hi, Ben.
I'd like to...
So you were on.
asked why you have property. You said, well, that's just the way things are. You were asked, is it fair and moral? You said, well, reality has been such that, the industry hasn't been too fair to most artists, but that's the way things have been. And about 2 minutes before that, you said you can't legislate the market away. But the arguments that have been made have been that, in fact, technology is changing the market. And what is happening to the distributors vis-a-vis you, the intermediaries are leaving and suddenly creating relationships, is, in fact, if the technology were left alone, happening to you. So the problem isn't that you're legislating the market away, it's that you're trying to legislate the market into being so that it doesn't change from what it is now, where you can have these historical, morally unfortunate, but nonetheless historical market conditions. So the story that's told instead is that if you would just get out of the way with your laws, artists would have relationships with their audience. They would live on relationships with their audience, and you would go and do something else. That, I didn't hear an answer to that argument, which seems to me to be the more salient. And I suppose the question to Mark is that a plausible story from your view of art and art?
Oh, that's brilliantly put, and kind of relates to what I wanted to ask Cary too, is, you know, what behind closed doors, does anyone in the IRA say, what happens if we can't figure out how to make this new medium work the way we're used to? What if it just never works? And for me, I understand, you know, you make a living. People have families. They want to have, it's very basic. It's survival. People just want to, you know, keep paying those bills. But when all the things I have seen of how the treatment between business and artists in the music industry is so vile, that I just feel no sympathy for the victimized cries coming from the industry of, oh God, we've got to make this thing work the same way we're used to and keep making money off you people out there. And I don't, in some, you know, in an individual sense, yep, you want to keep your job, you want to have your house, you want to, but in some, in another perspective, I don't have a lot of sympathy for it. It's like, Cary, so it's going to change. No.
May I just say that the time is now up and you don't have to
respond. No, but I'm really...
I really didn't want to leave the impression that I thought that artists have been treated unfairly. I just said that the economics of the marketplace is that there are different types of relationships at different points in time. Believe me, if you talk to labels, they will tell you how they can be victimized by superstars just the way young artists will tell you how they have been victimized by labels. It's a very divergent marketplace out there, so I just wanted to correct that.
But that's such a tiny, it's a tiny percentage of the people out there are making this. Yeah, go ahead.
I'm not sure what you mean by legislate a market into being, because we really haven't... But we have actually not attempted to legislate that. The only legislation that we supported on this was the DMCA in terms of when... Wait a minute. No, there are a lot of other legal regimes out there that are being proposed that go well beyond the DMCA in terms of making technology subservient to content. And the DMCA as the only thing that we supported in terms of saying that if you have an effective measure on its own, that you shouldn't be able to sell products to break that system, we don't think is a bad piece of legislation. We think that DVD, for example, became a market that consumers love because it had some encryption. Motion picture studios felt comfortable putting it out. It's illegal to break the system. You know, how it applies in the DCSS case, I know, very complicated set of issues for First Amendment and all that. But in terms of saying that if you're going to have to rely on technical protection measures in order to create marketplaces in an uncontrolled technology world, it is not unreasonable to have some limit on breaking, on circumventing the technology. But we have not attempted in any way to control the technologies. We haven't said that any technologies should be illegal. We haven't suggested that the marketplace should be subservient to the content. The problem is companies are trying to launch legitimate businesses into a marketplace where technology can supersede anything that they do. And the only way that they're going to be able to do it ultimately, I think, is to offer better consumer value, a more compelling market opportunity that is going to drive people to the legitimate marketplace instead of the underground marketplace. That's a very tough thing to sell. It's going to be tough to do. But this is not a matter of trying to get legislation to protect the interest. The companies understand that the reality is the reality, and they're just going to have to adapt the business models. And the business models are going to adapt throughout the industry. You talk about artists going directly to the internet. That's fine. I think that's one of the things that will help level the playing field in this marketplace. A number of the artists who have already gone directly to the internet have not found it a very satisfying experience because one of the things that record companies do is market and promote artists. They help distinguish the wheat from the chaff. And that makes a big difference to artists who want that particular role of record companies. But artists who don't want it will have that freedom. Everybody will have the freedom to choose what they want. Record companies are not the only ones who can be disintermediated here. The retailers are worried about being disintermediated as well. Disintermediation is in the eye of the beholder. Who is being disintermediated? Record companies may just become different. They may perform marketing and promotion functions, but not distribution functions. But there will always be that function being served, that's for sure. And I don't know whether they'll be called record companies or whatever, but it will change. And the relationship between artists and labels is going to change. Right now, artists and labels have a relationship on one thing, the sale of CDs. And that's why record companies feel like they are very generous to artists. They pay them money in order to create CDs that they go out and market and promote at great expense. And then the CDs can be ripped off freely, whether on the internet or elsewhere. But the artist makes all the money and keeps all the money from the touring, the merchandising, the publishing, the endorsements, the rest of the career. You know, a better model would probably be where they were true partners in all the revenue sources and they had common interests. It hasn't been so far, but I think all of that will change over time. I think we're just going to have to see how this marketplace evolves.
That's it.